So, welcome to my talk through of my June 2022 longevity review newsletter. In case you had the misfortune of seeing my first attempt yesterday, I've got a t-shirt on this time in case I once again my camera instead of my screen, but hopefully that's not the case as I did test this out just a few minutes ago. Anyway, thank you for and strap on for the ride. So, without further ado, we'll continue. I mean, my news starts with a little plug for the Canadian Longevity Association. So, if you're in Canada, or even if you're not, please consider taking a look at us and request joining us. You can see, oops, you can see our temporary website. We're working on a new one. You can contact us via the contact form. But yes, I'd love you for you to join our association. That'd be most useful. Otherwise, working our way down here, I'll just briefly mention the Canadian Longevity Spotlight for this month. It was taking a look at an organization called Less Death, run by Mark Hamalainen, Canadian living in California. And Less Death is an organization aimed at getting more people to join the longevity movement or get involved working in the longevity scene. And taking a look at this website, they ran a summer camp, which was very, very successful. Back in July, heard some very positive reviews of it, and they'll be holding another summer camp. You can see here educational workshops, career strategizing, mapping the critical path, and as I say, it was lots of fun according to people who went, and I'm certainly thinking about going attending the one next year, which will be sometime in the summer. But yes, definitely worth checking out. Getting now to the meat of the matter. So, looking at the highlights of June by going through the roundup section here. So, the first paper we're going to sort of take a look at is a paper aimed at slowing the development and progression of age-related macular degeneration, which is one of the leading causes of blindness in older age. And there's actually a follow-up to a study which has been running for more than 10 years. And actually is related to a study that started way back in the 1990s, where they tried a combination of supplements aimed at preventing the progression of macular degeneration. Now, in that original study, they used, as the study was launched in 1996, they used 500 milligrams of vitamin C, 400 international units of vitamin E, 2 milligrams copper, 80 milligrams zinc, and 15 milligrams beta carotene. Now, good news of this study was that it significantly reduced the progression of AMD. However, on the flip side, amongst people who smoked, in this study, they had a significantly higher risk of lung cancer than expected. So they might have had their sight saved, but then they died of lung cancer. So I'm not quite sure that was the, best thing to do. Anyway, in this new study, they replaced beta carotene with, so yeah, the new study was started in 2006, and it replaced beta carotene with 10 milligrams of lutein and 2 milligrams zeaxanthin. I'm not actually sure how to pronounce that, but anyway, zeaxanthin, let's call it that. And in this study, in the after the initial 5-year phase, it reduced the risk of AMD progression by about 26%, which is great. And and anyway, this study, this sort of follow-on extra 5 years of study, there was an additional reduce risk of progression of AMD compared to those originally assigned to receive beta carotene. Because in this second study, it was not only checking testing lutein and zeaxanthin, but also it included some more people taking beta carotene. And this it was a 20% improvement over the original beta carotene. However, most importantly, there was no increase in lung cancer. So the people that the follow-up study, people who took beta carotene, you know, they had a risk of their risk of getting lung cancer nearly doubled. So and there was no increased risk of lung cancer with this new formulation with lutein and zeaxanthin. So good news if you want to reduce your risk of getting of progressing with AMD and also not getting lung cancer. Looking at the next study now, this one is about female reproductive lifespan, and this is a little bit of a mea culpa. I might have mentioned this in my last video that I guess primarily because I'm a male and I have no desire for children. Sort of reproductive health was not something that I had really focused on, but I guess I've become aware or more aware about how obviously important it is for lots of who want to start a family, especially later in life. And so the delaying of ovarian aging would be very beneficial for them. Anyway, in this study here, they used two anti-fibrotic drugs, pirfenidone and BGP-15, which, this is in mice, I should say, eliminated fibrotic collagen and restored ovulation in reproductively old and obese mice. Again, they say here, this is the first evidence that ovarian fibrosis is reversible. So this is obviously potentially good news. I mean, again, I have to emphasize this was in mice, but anything which can increase the a woman's reproductive years is obviously beneficial. Well, if you want to have children, that is, I guess. Anyway, moving on to the next one. So this one is dealing with treating hearing loss. And as I say here, especially speech in noise. So what does speech in noise mean? Basically, whenever, I'm sure you've been, if you've ever been in a really noisy restaurant or bar or someplace like that and trying to have a conversation, and it might be difficult to hear what the other person is saying, or to indeed follow conversations in general, if it's very noisy, increases with age. And scientists or a company have developed a neurotrophic approach involving a peptide, I think. Hold on, let's go down here. Neurotrophic factor. They found something which they've called OTO413, which increased the amount of BDNF, which is brain derived neurotrophic factor, which helps sort of neurons grow in the brain. And in this phase 1/2 clinical trial, it improved speech and noise hearing performance in subjects with hearing loss. So again, this is a very small trial, only a few people. It's more a safety trial than anything else, but anything that can improve people's hearing is a good thing. Now even better that after I saw this this published study, which came out in June, did a bit of investigation and realized that the same company behind it had a press release a couple of months prior showing that they'd already moved on to a phase 2A clinical trial. of OTO413, in which the previous findings were sort of replicated. Slightly larger group of people, but again, not that many people. And you can see here, the results at the bottom, 40% or 8 out of 20 people, again, small number of people, demonstrated a clinically meaningful improvement in at least one of three speech and noise tests at both 57 and 85 days after, I guess, administration, compared to 20%, 2 out of 10 for the placebo group, and 15% of this OTO-415 subjects has demonstrated a clinically meaningful improvement in two or more different SIN tests on both of those days, whereas nobody in the placebo group had similar outcomes. And for the words and noise test, 40%, 16 out of 15 who could be evaluated, demonstrated a clinically meaningful improvement on both days, compared to 0% of the placebo group. So some more results. Again, these are very small trials, so they need a bigger trial. I think they're going to say that Autonomy, I guess the company behind this, they expect to initiate a full dose ranging phase 2 efficacy trial by the end of this year. So yeah, good to hear, pun fully intended, that this is not just in mice, but potentially showing some a meaningful improvement in humans as well. Carrying forth, apart from hearing loss, another thing older people unfortunately experience is a loss of muscle mass, muscle wasting, also called, the scientific name is called, it's called sarcopenia. And maintaining muscle mass is very important for daily functioning and quality of life. And indeed, there's a inverse correlation between muscle mass and mortality. So maintaining muscle mass is very is crucial. Now, and scientists are trying numerous methods to increase muscle mass in the elderly. In this case, which is also a human trial, a rodent study, this scientist, a probiotic or a multi-strain probiotic. So that means they basically gave certain bacteria, certain microorganisms for humans to take and colonize their digestive system with, I guess. And this resulted in an improved HGS, which is hand grip strength, how much you can squeeze something, gait speed, how much someone is able how fast someone's able to walk, and plasma DKK1, which I think is an indicator of intestinal permeability, which you do not want. Again, small trial, only less than 100 people inside it for a short time, only 12 weeks, but still potentially, I guess you can take probiotics in pill form. So something as simple as changing the composition of your gut bacteria might improve your sarcopenia, improve your muscle mass and all that. So this is potentially a very simple and probably cheap method of improving that, if it's it holds true in larger and later phase trials. Okay, looking at the last study that I've put in the roundup section. This is more sort of a fundamental biology paper. Something I was quite excited about actually when I saw this, because it's opening a whole new vista, or a whole new unexplored space in the fertility scene. What do I mean by that? Let me explain. So the very first indication, might as well go to the paper itself. The very first indication that lifespan is malleable or could be extended came about by some genetic population of some very simple worms, and scientists found that when they were just knocking out in the worm, see what happens to the worm. You know, if they take out a gene, is the worm going to die? Is it not be able to grow? Is it, what's going to happen to it? The expectation being that if they knocked out a gene, it would stop. You know, something bad would happen. In the late 80s and early 90s. A couple of groups of scientists discovered by knocking out certain genes, which they actually managed to extend the lifespan of worms, in some cases by quite a considerable extent. Those clearly were non-essential. So by taking them out, they made the animal live longer, therefore, yeah, they're not essential. And they found that in general, like many, quite a few, number of genes actually were found to increase lifespan by being taken out. But roughly 3.5% of genes were found to affect lifespan, upon their deletion. So that's what studies in the past have done. What it caught my eye, and why I was quite excited by this study, is that the scientists here undertook the opposite approach. Instead of taking out a gene that was not essential, they instead looked at essential genes, genes that if you took them out would kill the animal or make it not live as well. And instead of taking them out, they increased their expression. So they genetically manipulated them so that they would increase their expression, see what happened. And they did this in cerevisiae, which is basically yeast, brewer's yeast or baker's yeast. And here they found that, I'll read it out, by taking the approach of increasing the expression levels of a subset of conserved essential genes, we found that 21% of these genes resulted in increased replicative lifespan. So it basically made them live longer. And so, I mean, yeah, this is quite exciting because, well, this is the first paper that I've seen, or in fact, the authors say it's the first paper that they're aware of any group attempting this approach. I mean, it's early days, but as I say, it opens up a whole new vista, a whole new field of opportunities. Understanding more about aging and, you know, what parts of our genome are crucial for longevity and which ones, you know, we can potentially be enhanced, improve or extend our own healthy longevity. So, yeah, I thought this was quite interesting indeed. Okay, let's carry on to, having finished the roundup there, let us carry on to the supplemental section. Look at some more supplements and some other interesting stories. I'm only gonna dip in and out a few of these, so take your time looking at these. I mean, you know, diet and good diet is always good for you. Exercise is always good for you. Here, so I always try to concentrate on human studies if I can, and here is a systemic review and meta-analysis of resveratrol in metabolic indicators in patients with type 2 diabetes. So resveratrol was the hyped supplement of 15 years ago, found in red wine and all this, claimed falsely to extend the lifespan of mice, though it did increase the lifespan of obese mice. I went through the whole hype cycle. Now it's not considered that as relevant anymore. But quite a number of studies have taken place with resveratrol over the last decade or so, and a lot of them were quite small studies, which might not be significant. But this what the authors here have done is that they've done a systematic review, so all of the studies done in relation to metabolic indicators in patients with type 2 diabetes. And so that, of course, means that there. It's this year. So this meta-analysis included 19 studies involving 1,151 patients. So I don't know, 584 treated with resveratrol, the others treated with placebo. So it gives you a much better better chance to have a statistically significant result. Anyway, after I won't go through all the details, you can take a look at this yourself. But the conclusion was that prove that resveratrol treatment can reduce systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure. That's the two readings you get when you get test your blood pressure. And obviously, reducing blood pressure is a good thing, and that high doses of resveratrol, which more than 1,000 milligrams per day, I guess, can also reduce fasting blood glucose in patients with type 2 diabetes, though although it has no effect on waist circumference, triglyceride, or high density lipoprotein cholesterol. But still, so an indication that maybe it's resveratrol does at least or has at least some beneficial effects, so probably not as great effects as we thought 15 years ago. Hopefully you can't hear the dog barking in the background, but anyway. So don't quite give up on resveratrol yet. I take 250 milligrams a day myself. Another human trial, this time looking at omega-3 fatty acids, and they just like resveratrol may looks like they also can reduce blood pressure. Let's take a look at the Science Daily version here. And here, basically, what they've discovered was that about 3 grams of daily omega-3 fatty acids consumed in food or supplements appears to be the optimal dose to help lower blood pressure. Which, I mean, it's fish oil supplements or just omega-3 supplements readily available, not that expensive. And let's take a look at the details. So at 3 grams a day of omega-3s, again, systolic blood pressure decreased an average of 4.5 millimeters for those with hypertension and about 2 millimeters on average for those without. So people with high blood pressure already saw a greater benefit than people with good blood pressure. But generally speaking, I mean, unless it gets re really too low, the lower the better. Shows that your arteries are more elastic and there's less pressure on your heart and all this type of thing. So, once again, I take omega-3s myself. I don't actually take 3 grams. That's a bit. Yeah, I guess I'm probably taking around 1 gram or so a day or something like that. I mean, I might up it. I mean, I don't have high blood pressure, so it's not the biggest concern of mine at the moment. But yes, if you certainly have high blood pressure, it might be a good idea to take omega-3s and take sort of a higher dose of them. Let's say 3 grams seems to be optimal. Moving away from human studies now, and looking at an interesting combination. So if you've heard me before or read anything I've written, I always bang on about it's all about the combinations. No, there's not going to be one single magic bullet for longevity. It's always about combining things. Anyway, this is to do about osteoarthritis. and people take various supplements to try to combat any osteoarthritis that they have or general arthritis, pain in their joints. And chondroitin sulfate is one popular supplement that is quite often used, quite often combined with glucosamine and also sometimes with MSM. And here they combined it instead with curcumin, which is the main bioactive ingredient in turmeric, the yellow Indian spice commonly found in curries. And here they found that, again, this is in mice only, but rats. They found that both chondroitin and curcumin improved the osteoarthritis in rats and improved cartilage injury. However, when they combined the two together, they saw meanwhile, obvious repair of cartilage with higher contains collagen 2 could be observed in the curcumin and chondroitin group than the ones in the only curcumin or only chondroitin group. In addition, so downregulation of whatever P65 is in the combined group. And two markers of inflammation, IL-1 beta and MMP3, were downregulated significantly in the combined group as well. So, and I should also say that curcumin turmeric is also really cheap, and you can add it to food quite simply. I drink a drink with herbs and spices and turmeric inside. I drink that every day. And I also do take a combo, glucosamine, chondroitin, sulfate, and MSM. Not because I have joint issues, but and again, there's no evidence that it prevents the development of any of them, but that's my hope. So it's nice to see that the combination of these chondroitin curcumin could be further beneficial or synergistic. Carrying forward, another mouse study or maybe rat study. I'm guessing mice. Let's see if I was correct. With my favorite anti-aging drug, or the drug longevity drug, I think is closest to prime time, along with possibly senolytics, and which I am actually going to start taking myself in just over a week's time, which I'm quite excited about. But anyway, amongst the many potential beneficial aspects of rapamycin is that it might help prevent Alzheimer's and cognitive decline. So I just wanted to point this out, that they investigated that it, rapamycin reverses neurovascular uncoupling. Basically, it appears to improve the blood flow in the mice, and present study suggests that mTOR promotes cerebrovascular dysfunction in Alzheimer's disease. So mTOR is what actually rapamycin stops. So mTOR to promote cerebrovascular disease. And so our studies highlight the potential of mTOR attenuation, means reduction, as an efficacious method for treatment for Alzheimer's disease and potentially other neurologic diseases of aging. So here it was in that. Oops, where'd it go? There we go. Yeah, that mTOR attenuation with rapamycin is sufficient to restore neurovascular coupling and even enhance it above the wild type response. Anyway, you can read the rest of the paper. But yes, so fortunately, it appears that there is a trial I'm not sure it started yet. They're going to be testing out rapamycin in Alzheimer's patients. So keep an eye out for that. In terms of neuroprotection, improving cognition, canagliflozin, an SGLT2 inhibitor, which is commonly prescribed for diabetes patients to lower blood glucose levels. It's a sodium glucose transporter 2 inhibitor. A new class of diabetes drugs, which have recently been shown to improve heart function in not only diabetic patients, but also patients with like heart failure and things like that. And in recently, I mean, there are various different SGLT2 inhibitors out there. Canagliflozin is simply one of them. And I think they've all shown these sort of similar benefits for the heart. Anyway, in canagliflozin was also in the interventions testing program, which tests potential longevity drugs in mice. This is done by the Institute of Aging in the U.S. And it's the gold standard for longevity interventions in mice. And when they tested canagliflozin, it improved longevity by 14%, but unfortunately only in male mice. In this sort of follow-up study, they looked at cognition and did a few other things that improved insulin responsiveness in aged male mice, which is a good thing, and it improved exploratory and locomotor activity in 30-month-old male but not female mice. So sorry, ladies, and this is not really of any benefit to you, but for men, if you're on an SGLT2 inhibitor, then it might help with your cognition, as well as your diabetes and heart function as well. So just an indication of a benefit of a widely consumed drug. Carrying on, what did I want to look at? Oh yes, I could not but include this story here, that lager beer, whether it contains alcohol or not, could help men's gut microbes. So there's a thing, is Science Daily. Yeah, Science Daily. Take a look at the abstract, because look at some of the details. You can read the Science Daily article at your leisure. But in this trial, they gave 22 lucky men, they had to drink either 330 milliliters, so not much, of either non-alcoholic or alcoholic beer at 5.2% daily over the course of 4 weeks. And what they found out was that regardless of whether they had the beer with alcohol or no alcohol, though I don't see what the point of beer with no alcohol is, but maybe this is a point, non-alcoholic and alcoholic beer increased gut microbiota diversity, which is a good thing. We want to have sort of a more diverse digestive tract. Intended to increase fecal alkaline phosphatase activity and marker intestinal barrier function. Again, I mentioned before, we want our intestines to block any pathogens from going, from entering our body via our digestive tract. So these results suggest that the effects of beer on gut microbiota modulation are independent of alcohol, maybe mediated by beer polyphenols. So nutrients in the beer might be beneficial, though I have a feeling that the amount of beer I tend to drink over the course of a week is might not be quite as beneficial. Certainly it's I drink slightly more on average than 330 milliliters. Oh, yeah. Always trying to cut down a little bit. I don't drink excessively, I'll be honest with you. But yeah, certainly I probably should drink a little bit less. But I had to share that. I had to share it for any beer drinkers out there. It's not only a bad thing. Okay, Leon, now looking at two studies coming up. And so women, ladies, you missed out on the canaglia flows in study, but here are a couple ones aimed at you. And the first one is for anyone entering or experiencing menopause. It's not the most fun experience in one's life, as I heard at length from my own mother as she was going through it. Anything that can have an effect on the symptoms is obviously beneficial. And here they find that two couple treatments are often discussed: curcumin and vitamin E, improved inflammatory oxidative stress biomarkers and primary symptoms of menopause in healthy postmenopausal women. And here they took either 500 milligrams or curcumin twice a day, so I guess a gram, and or 500 milligrams of vitamin E twice a day. They only tested one or the other. Unfortunately, they did not test the combination. But however, what they did find is that curcumin could improve the oxidative stress measured by MDA and TAC and inflammatory biomarkers, right, as measured by the C-reactive protein test. While vitamin E also may also improve the antioxidant status by increasing the TAC levels. And also in addition, vitamin E seemed to improve the anxiety of the group compared to placebo. So yeah, it could be an idea if you are about to experience menopause or going through menopause. It could be an idea to make sure you're taking vitamin E or curcumin. I don't want to guess that the combination might be even more useful, but perhaps. Anyway, let us now take a look at the final paper that we're going to take a look at. And this one was a paper which I kind of missed. I actually didn't read properly the first time when I put my newsletter together. It was only yesterday for this talk through that I took a look at it more detailed. And I'll tell you why. I'll tell you about this paper. So this is also about extending reproductive longevity. And, not reproductive longevity, but protecting the reproductive health of women, especially those who have undergone chemotherapy, and especially cisplatin chemotherapy. Chemotherapy. So cisplatin is a platinum-based chemotherapy and has serious... I'll read the first sentence. Your ovarian damage induced by platinum-based chemotherapy seriously affects young women with cancer, manifesting in infertility, early menopause, and premature ovarian insufficiency. So premature, ovarian aging. Now, what they tried was a combination of senolytics, our old friends dasatinib and quercetin, which are the most studied senolytics. So just a reminder, senolytics remove dysfunctional cells from our bodies. I also should mention this was in mice, not humans. And also the anti-diabetic drug metformin. Now here they did do combinations. So they used the combination of dasatinib, quercetin, more commonly just known as D&Q. They tested that on its own, metformin on its own, and then the combination of both together, so independently or in combination. And what they found that both D and Q and metformin individually improved things. However, when combined, they synergistically improved things. So let's read the conclusion. In this study, we demonstrated that metformin plus D and Q recovered ovarian function to a greater extent compared to metformin or D and Q independently, with more follicular reserve, increased pups per liter, and reduced DNA damage. So quite, once again, I love combinations. So the question that pops into my mind now is just whether, adding metformin in general to other, adding metformin to other studies of D and Q would further improve the potential good effects of D and Q. Once again, no single treatment is going to cure aging. It's going to be a combination of different treatments and modalities. So yeah, that's what I wanted to. I will just add that if you enjoyed this and you wish to support the work I am doing, which is indirectly, well, directly supporting the Canadian Longevity Association, because I've given up my job to just do this full time, and I'm just, apart from getting some support from my parents, I don't have an income. Doesn't have an income yet, but I've got a Patreon account, and if you go there, you can, I don't know, sign up. You get my newsletters. You directly. I'm only getting five patrons so far. 50, 53, $23 a month. Anyway, every little helps. So yes, if you enjoy these, please consider giving me a, buying me a cup of coffee or what have you. Anyway, plug finished, and is the end of this. I will. Oh no, it's not. You can't see my camera. Anyway, I'm gonna stop sharing because. Well, and that which will end the end this broadcast. So thank you for watching, and look forward to hopefully you will join me and my next talk through. Cheers.